There are many studies which show that our happiness is dependent on biodiversity. Much ever you can talk about virtual reality, there's nothing like actual experience. Mm-hmm. It's really important for us to reconnect with our wildlife.
Uma, we were talking about the wild animal and the biodiversity. So how important is it for a country like us, which is actually a developing country? And how do you think this is going to make a difference for us?
So I think that it's really critical, right? I mean, I think that as we were just talking, you know, a lot of the problems we face as a country are because of water, pollution, so many things, floods, and all of that. For all of that, biodiversity is critical. For our own well-being, you know, for our happiness, there are many studies which show that our happiness is dependent on biodiversity. And I think we are also lucky because despite India, the area that India occupies is about 2.3% of the world. But the biodiversity we have is almost 8% versus 2.5% area. So it's really important for us to save this biodiversity for our future, for the future of the kids, and also the future of the world.
Okay. But could you tell us, like, what would be the behavioral patterns because of having and not having biodiversity?
Many times we try to ape Western countries. You know, we say, okay, we want to have development like America or something like that. And a lot of these places, they've already lost their biodiversity. They've already lost it, and they are going a different way where they are replanting. You know, they are actually doing research on how to get those intact systems back. The thing for them is they may be able to do it because in the temperate areas, the colder areas in the West, the number of species is only less. Mm-hmm. So if you have a forest, you may have a few species, whereas in tropics like in India, there's a lot of species. And you can imagine, like in a big city, there's a lot of complexity, a lot more interactions. It becomes very difficult. And there's many studies which show that green cover makes you feel happier, right? There's other ways now we are looking at this biodiversity. So recently, there's been a huge technological change in genomics. You hear the word or read the word genomics a lot. And so with some new equipments and new machines like next generation sequencing, we can actually understand more about biodiversity. Like some of the work I do is looking at tigers, and we basically read tiger genomes so that we can understand more about the behavioral pattern of tigers, how can we ensure that they survive, and so on. So biodiversity impacts us in terms of our positive feelings. I think anyone would feel like if there's no park or anything, right, you will feel depressed, you will feel very low, right? But when you have that nature, it's a really good outlet.
Do you have any specific reason why do you think there is a stimulant in us because of wild animals?
We are also animals, right?
Yes.
So we really also, like, just like we have a sense of wonder, right? So everyone is curious about space. Mm-hmm. Everyone is curious about how does the mind work. Just like that, everybody loves animals. Everybody is really curious about waterfalls or hiking, seeing mountains and snow. It's part of our this one. And how much ever you can talk about virtual reality, there's nothing like actual experience. Mm-hmm. And actually, like I said, we are lucky that we can have that experience. Mm-hmm. So there are many programs now, like I was mentioning, citizen science programs, where school kids can get involved in, you know, monitoring birds or looking at flowering, when is a plant flowering. And this also teaches you about science. Like, as you observe things, you ask more questions. As you ask more questions, you look for more answers.
Right.
And that process of discovery is like research.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not only, you know, you have to be a professor to do research. Even a small six-year-old child can do research.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So biodiversity, because it's all around us, just like you can tinker, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can try to make something. Just like that, biodiversity is a space for you to do research and explore who you are,
mm-hmm.
as a child, as a person. What are you?
Mm-hmm. You have extensively worked with wild animals, specifically to the tiger.
Yeah.
Could you tell us what was that curiosity of yours in initial, and what is today?
Okay. So so basically, tigers are, like I said, very charismatic. I mean, anywhere you go in the world, you will find you know, like whether it's a bus on a street, you'll find some picture of a tiger, some this one. So it's a big fascination for all of us through time also. A lot of old paintings also, if you see, you'll see tigers. So I was like everyone, I was also fascinated by tigers. And when I started my job here, I got an opportunity to work with Dr. Ullas Karanth, who's a very famous tiger biologist. And he asked whether I would be interested in working with him. So I just kind of jumped into it. I had done most of my education, PhD onwards, in the US, and I just came back and, you know, I just jumped into it. But since then, I think I have gotten much more invested in, somehow we have to make sure tigers survive, right? Mm-hmm. Now it's India's responsibility, it's a national priority. The Prime Minister has said, we must make sure tigers survive. In fact, 29th is International Tiger Day.
Oh, okay.
Coming up, 29th of July. And so I feel like I'm also doing something for the country. Mm-hmm. I'm also doing something for the world and for the country. And it's really nice to feel that your work has some meaning.
Mm-hmm. Listening only, it is very fascinating to me. there is one more thing I would like to push you for, to ask. Was there any particular behavioral pattern of an animal which was very new to you and you felt this is something which I never had in my life?
Oh, yeah. So all animals are fantastic to watch in the wild. So for example, when you watch tigers in the wild, they are like cats, you know, they look so big and you might imagine, oh my God, they're so scary. But then, you know, they just roll around. And when you see the young babies, they are always so irritating, you know, you can see that the mother is always so irritated by the babies. So many things, when we watch them, we relate to them. But see, I think when we only see in zoo or something, we're not able to relate like that.
Right.
But when we see the behavior in the wild, elephants, for example, the young elephants are always screeching and shouting and playing with each other, you know, and it's just amazing. It feels like a gift to be able to see all these species in the wild and to really experience their behavior. Monkeys, they're just like us. They're just like us. They look at us, they'll tease us, they'll taunt us, right? Mm-hmm. So it's just amazing to see that you're not alone.
Yeah.
And you're not so special also. All over the world, there are other species, other animals, which are just like you.
Yeah. Taking a cue from what you're saying, do you think it is not right to have zoos?
So I think, you know, zoos have a very interesting history. They started as menageries, you know, people who would catch all these fantastic looking animals, and also people they would have in these menageries, you know, people, a lady with a beard, or, you know, these kind of people. And we don't do that today. We don't have circuses, we don't have zoos of that kind. But zoos have taken on a different role. See, now everybody cannot come to India and see a tiger. But a person who sees a tiger in the US may decide they want to really donate a lot of money for tiger conservation. So they may have a role to build awareness for outreach and to build, you know, just awareness about conservation, about species, you know. So if they're good zoos and they really try to represent the habitat of the species, it's kind of like a virtual reality, right?
Yeah.
Bringing that species to you. Like for me to go to Amazon and see something may be very hard, but if I see it in the zoo, I get a flavor for it.
Right. Yeah. Uma, with various natural calamities taking place, like recently in flood at Assam and decrease in the biodiversity and impact on the forest, assuming that this continues and in the name of the development, a lot of forest been cut down. So what do you think would happen to us if there are no wild animals in the future?
No, that's not an acceptable option at all. So, I mean, you can't talk about, you know, it's like saying, you know, there's no parents or something like that. We're all part of a family, we're all part of a, you know, a network, and it's just not acceptable at all. And I think this is really important for us to take in very, very strongly, because we keep thinking, you know, we're so much more connected to the internet and our devices these days. From a small child, everyone's on the phone all the time. We're not even connecting with each other.
Right.
And it's really important for us to reconnect with our wildlife, with our wildlands, with our rivers, with our mountains, because there's so much of beauty and wonder, and that will also help us be better innovators, because we'll be curious, we'll look around, we'll think about things. Many technological innovations also have come from nature, right? So I think to not have nature is not acceptable, and it's all of our responsibilities to make sure that's not an eventuality.
So maybe I think we should have a day where we cut down internet, not phone actually.
Yeah, I think so.
And then maybe stay with families around and go around.
Go somewhere. Go outside somewhere, see nature. I think it's really a precious gift we have, which we're just ignoring.
Okay. Thank you, Uma, for various insights on the wildlife and their exciting journey which connects to the human beings.
Yeah.
And I'm sure children who are watching this will be interested and curious to find out more about it.
Yeah.
And looking forward for again further discussion with you.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.